Welcome, welcome, three times welcome, Chicago. Welcome into the first hour of the Focus Show, and I am your host, Lofton Emenari III, and we have a great show for you. Tonight we're going until 9 o'clock, and we've got, we've got some hot-button topics to discuss. In our first hour, we are to discuss Scientology, the Nation of Islam, and the black community. And we're going to talk to activists Leila Wills and Ishmael Bay. And in the second hour, we'll talk to Vita Starr about the black atheists in America. So we want you to keep it right here at 88.5 FM. And remember, we stream live at www.whpk.org. That's www.whpk.org. And you know, I'm usually here every other Sunday with What Is This Thing Called Jazz? Adventures in Modern Music. But tonight, the Focus Show, and we've got our guests queued up. Leila and Ishmael, are you there?
We are here.
Good.
Yes, Lofton. How are you doing this evening?
Good, good, good. Good to have you guys on. It's been a long time coming. You know, to apprise our audience of what we're going to talk about tonight, Scientology, the Nation of Islam, and the black community. What a topic. now, to tell our audience a little bit about the both of you, Ishmael, you were at one time a member of the Nation of Islam. Am I correct?
Yes, that's correct. I was a member of the Nation of Islam for approximately about a decade, and was in the minister's ranks of the Nation of Islam. Mm. And also, prior to actually joining the organization, I was a member of a faction of the Nation of Islam, and still a proud member, which is called the Nation of Gods and Earth, since 1982.
Mm. Well, you know what? There are a lot of factions, I'll tell you that much.
Yes, very true.
I was a part of several of those here in Chicago. In fact, here in Chicago, there are about five, I know.
Yes, sir. Absolutely correct. Yes, sir.
Well, and then, Leila, you've written a new book called Farrakhan the Movie. Can you give us a synopsis of that?
Okay, yeah. Farrakhan the Movie was, and it is a movie, like it's a movie script, but I put it in book form. It's something I had been working on since 2002, so that's what it is, and it just came out in May, and it's about the minister's rise to power in the Nation of Islam. It's a lot of the history of the Nation of Islam. Just it's a lot of facts and data, and it covers the very beginning from 1930 all the way until present day. So it's a lot of information, but it's a fast and easy read, you know, and it's written in movie style, so it kind of plays out in your head as it goes along.
Now, I have to let our listeners know that I met you two across the vast empire, the vastness of the internet, of course, you know, on Facebook. And and one of the things about that kind of social medium, it brings all kind of people together, especially for the group that I met you both in. And tell us the name of that group that you've got.
Yes, the name of the forum is called Scientology Invasion of the Black Community.
Mm.
And we came up with that particular title because it was based upon a DVD that myself and another brother, Professor Isel, we came out with a DVD under that name.
Mm-hmm.
So we decided to expand that into an actual forum using the multimedia network.
Now, the forum, as I've seen over the past month, I think I've been a member of the forum maybe 2 months now. How long has the forum been out on Facebook?
It's actually been out for about 2 months. You were one of the early members of that. And, of course, we have a couple hundred members.
Right.
We disseminate the information, and actually you were in on the ground level, one of the first guests.
Wow.
And now our Facebook group is so powerful.
Yes.
And it's filled with so many experts. We have not only people from how you just discussed the different factions of the Nation of Islam, mm-hmm. we have the general black community, you know, as a whole, you know, different parts of our community represented. We have former Scientologists who come on with their story. Mm-hmm. We have cult experts. We have we have a powerful group on Facebook. We really do.
Yes, it is. I'll tell you. And just about every day, I always learn something new. That's the thing that blows my mind about it. You know, let's begin at the beginning, so to speak. And how did you all see the need for such a group?
Well, what happened was we wanted to, there were some things that were transpiring, first initially through the Nation of Islam that kind of raised our antenna.
Mm-hmm.
There were some things that the Church of Scientology was doing international.
Mm.
In particular, there were some things that they were doing in South Africa. And we happened to have one of the founders of the forum, along with Leila and myself, Professor Iself, was living in South Africa.
Mm-hmm.
And he was going through so many things with the Church of Scientology. I started to make a correlation between what he was going through over in Africa to what was transpiring in the urban community through the Church of Scientology and the Nation of Islam.
Yes.
So by making that correlation, I was able to use it as a comparative study to find out what were they going to be doing next.
Mm.
So as soon as the professor, he was living over there for a couple of years, as soon as he came back to America, we immediately started to ring the alarm, letting our community know exactly what was going to be transpiring, and it's actually coming to fruition.
Now,
and at that time, that was a secret. I'm sorry to interrupt you.
That's all right. That's all right.
That was a secret relationship between the Nation of Islam and the Church of Scientology that the public was not aware. Even members inside of the nation were not aware. And Ishmael and Professor Iself were the first ones to go public with this secret relationship between these two groups.
Yes. Well, now, please forgive me as well, Leila. Now, you as well were a part of the Nation of Islam at one time, weren't you?
Uh-huh. Yes. I started going, I'm from Chicago, and started going to the Final Call when I was a teenager. So that was like in 87, 88, became a member in like 90, and I stayed for a while, and I left after the Million Man March. I would have left sooner, but I was very much involved with the march and a lot of work in the community, so I didn't leave until that was over. But the influence, even though I was gone from the ranks of the Nation of Islam, I was still not away from the Nation of Islam or the influence of the doctrine or anything like that. So not all the way until this situation with Scientology did my own personal antennas go up, like, wait a minute, what is going on here? So now with him making that move, him meaning Minister Farrakhan with Scientology, that made me have to go back to everything else that had transpired during my time and everything else that we thought we knew in history, because a move like that didn't just come out of nowhere.
Yes, you're absolutely right. Now, just for the sake of some of our listeners who may not know much about Scientology, can you give us a capsulized version on just what is this thing? Now, some people perhaps know it as a quote-unquote legitimate church, and then some know it as a quote-unquote cult. What is Scientology?
Certainly, Brother Lofton, that's a very good question. What we have is, first you have, before you get to Scientology, you have what's called Dianetics. Dianetics was founded in 1950. And Scientology was founded in 1952.
Mm.
So, in other words, once you started off with this branch of the Dianetics originally, it evolved into the Church of Scientology as the organization that we see. However, once you get into what's called the practice of Dianetics, you are actually simultaneously engaged in Scientology. You will have those people who try to separate Dianetics from Scientology, but that's the equivalent of trying to separate the apple from the tree.
So Dianetics could I call it a stepping stone to Scientology?
It is. It's a stepping stone, and it's also one of the phases as you move up in the overall umbrella, which is called Scientology. Dianetics is just one part of that evolutionary process.
Oh.
So a person may think that they're just practicing the technology of Dianetics, but in actuality, you're practicing Scientology itself.
Now,
Dianetics.
Mm-hmm,
sorry, go ahead.
No. Well, I was just going to ask, of course, Dianetics, I tried to read the book many years ago, probably about 30 years ago, and I just could not get through just any of it. It was just a maze to me. And we know the man that wrote it was L. Ron Hubbard. Who was this guy?
Yes. Leila, would you like to explain a little bit on L. Ron Hubbard?
Yeah, I would, but I would like to go back just a second. Because
yes.
Dianetics, I don't want us to not understand how important Dianetics is to Scientology.
Mm-hmm.
And what Scientology does, what they offer you, this is a religion that offers you what is called the bridge to total freedom.
Mm.
And Dianetics is the Bible of Scientology.
Yes.
L. Ron Hubbard is the Jesus of Scientology. And anything that he says, writes, does, whatever, is holy scripture. Dianetics is known as book one. So as soon as you start Dianetics, you are technically on the first step of the total bridge, the bridge to total freedom. Now, that would sound okay if you were able to get through Dianetics, which you weren't, Lofton. I don't know what that says about you, but once you get involved with these people and this religion, Scientology is a pay-as-you-go religion. So before we get into it being a cult, let's just deal with the fact that if you're a Christian, you go to church, you have your communion, you do these things that are part of your, you may have a counseling session with the pastor or something like that. Anything that you do in Scientology, you got to pay for it. You have to pay for every religious service that they give you, every book that they give you, everything, you have to pay for it. So that's another important aspect.
Pay as you go.
Pay as you go religion. And L. Ron Hubbard, I don't know what else to say about him. Some people, you guys are going to have to do a lot of research because there's so much data on him.
Yes.
And from what I understand is that he has a resume that Scientologists promote, and then there's the real story on who he was. So he has this glowing, he's a naval officer and all these fantastic things, but then when you look at the actual facts, he was none of those things. So he was a con man, he was a liar, he was a science fiction writer.
Mm-hmm.
He came up with a religion to make money, and that is the bottom line. Now, another thing about Scientology is that I don't know how far you want to go with this, but I want our people to understand that they use tactics. They use tactics to coerce you, to control your behavior, to control your thought patterns, and that mixed with a very the Nation of Islam's doctrine is already what a lot of people would consider extreme.
Mm-hmm.
So you're mixing these two extreme doctrines together, which to me is a very dangerous mix.
Now, you mentioned the Nation of Islam, and we're going to get into just their association with Scientology. But let me tell you, many years ago when I did try to get through Dianetics, I had someone tell me that Dianetics and Scientology at that time was no more than just a way to improve your life, one of these self-help sort of things. And at that very same time, the Scientology, and bear in mind, L. Ron Hubbard was dead, but the Scientology people were still pumping out his science fiction. Very strange indeed. Now, have you guys ever read any of his science fiction books? Have you ever tried? I'll put it that way.
I tried to read Dianetics. I've never read any of his books, his science fiction books. But I was like you when I came across, I saw one of those. Uh-oh. Are you still there?
Yes, I'm still here. We're still here.
Ishmael? Uh-oh, I think I lost Ishmael.
Looked like we lost Ishmael.
Well, yeah.
Well, I tell you what, let's take a short break, and we're going to try to get Ishmael back on the line. We are speaking with Leila Wills and, of course, Ishmael Bey, and we're talking about Scientology, the Nation of Islam, and the black community, and we'll be right back. Thank you. Alrighty, let's pick up where we just left off. Ishmael kind of dropped off the line there. Hey, you know, this is technology. What can we say? We are speaking with Leila Wells and Ishmael Bey, and we are talking about Scientology, the Nation of Islam, and the black community. We had left off speaking about L. Ron Hubbard himself. There's so many myths surrounding this man, but now tell me this. Now when did Scientology actually incorporate themselves to become a quote-unquote legitimate church?
Wasn't that in 53? I believe that was in 53.
Early.
Was it?
Yes, it was. It was approximately 1953, and they got the tax-exempt status actually pretty recently.
Mm-hmm. Now the Church of Scientology, it's a worldwide organization, is it not?
Mm-hmm.
It is. It's a worldwide organization in multiple countries and in multiple cities here in America, and they have a lot of star power as far as it's basically a celebrity rooted type of a quote-unquote so-called religion.
Right. Yes.
They cater to very rich people because those are the people who could afford their courses.
Now everyone knows pretty much about Tom Cruise's association with them. He's probably their most high profile person in Scientology. Really getting down to it, and you said it's a pay-as-you-go religion. When did they start making inroads or courting the black community in America?
They started making an overt type of a push, basically starting around, I would say, about 1996. Mm. It's kind of when it started being pushed as a part of the agenda.
Pretty recent.
Yes, a major player that kind of got in a little bit later on was Reverend Alfred E. Johnson. But you can see when they started to bring in the Isaac Hayes and start affiliating themselves with people like Chaka Khan and Will Smith and Dougie Fresh and MC Light and certain people, they started to find select people to get a black face on this Caucasian religion.
Mm. Now what possibly could a Dougie Fresh and a Chaka Khan find in Scientology? I have no clue, but perhaps you can give us some insight on these people wanting to associate with such a mind control kind of situation here.
Certainly, Brother Lofton, another very good question. What you'll find with Scientology is that it's truth mixed with falsehood. So within that truth factor, you're going to find some legitimate things that will probably be beneficial to people. The things that they deal with as far as psychoanalysis, things that they can offer as far as with the mind and things like that, it may be very beneficial for somebody to grow and to develop. So there are going to be some good things that you can find within it. There's always going to be a kernel of truth merged with that falsehood.
Right, exactly.
Well, also Lofton, on that is, if they consider anybody to have connections like a Chaka Khan would, or influence over a particular demographic like a Dougie Fresh or a MC Light, not saying they have huge, influence, but I'm just saying we recognize those people. Scientology will attach themselves to those people and do what they call love bombing, and they make Scientology sound like the greatest thing ever. They try to resurrect people's careers, and they schmooze these people. And so those people have a fantastic experience, and so they become like poster children to the rest of the community. But the central practice of Scientology is what they call auditing. Mm. Auditing is where that is the first hit of the crack pipe with Scientology. You read Dianetics, but you don't understand it, blah, 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 blah. So you got to do auditing hand in hand with Dianetics in order for you to be a complete sucker.
So auditing is, go ahead.
Yeah, what auditing is that if you, for example, I'll use Scientology's own promotional material. So if you had a traumatic experience or even just a bad experience that happened, like they use a guy who broke up with his girlfriend. So he sits there and you have an auditor. You end up having an audit, the same auditor. So what you're doing is building an interpersonal relationship with the same person where you become more and more trusting of this person, and then you start revealing more and more things of yourself. So, but at your initial thing, you broke up with your girlfriend. So the guy is telling the auditor, so they make you close your eyes. You have to relive the incident over and over and over again. And what they say to you is pull more data. So you recognize smells and tastes and what was going on. And I heard a police siren go by and all these things. And they say that that is releasing the charge of the negative charge that this event held for you. So at the same time you're doing Dianetics and you're being audited, you're becoming emotionally dependent on this auditing process and the person who's giving you the auditing, in my opinion, opinion of ex-Scientologists.
Now, this is a form of, I guess, of psychoanalysis.
And hypnosis.
Hypnosis and brain and mind control, it would seem to me. Now, you said that one of the poster child for Scientology in blackface was this Mr. L. Freddie Johnson. Who is this man?
He's one of the people who were very instrumental in actually bringing the Nation of Islam under the fold of Scientology. He was one of the people who worked in conjunction with Isaac Hayes, the great soul singer. He worked in conjunction with him, with Scientologists, and he had established some different community programs in Florida as well as in Los Angeles. So through his network in Los Angeles, he ended up using that as a foray into a relationship with the Nation of Islam out in Los Angeles. So he was one of the catalysts that started this particular ball rolling on this aspect of the invasion of our community.
Now, is this man, Freddie Johnson, is he a preacher? Is he a reverend? A pastor over a church or what?
Yes, he is. He's a Baptist. So he's a Baptist preacher.
Ah.
I'm assuming that with his relationship within Scientology, he ignores the fact that L. Ron Hubbard himself said that there is no Christ.
Yes.
So,
I'm sorry. Go ahead, Ishmael.
Yeah, I was going to say it's a walking contradiction for him to be a Baptist minister and to be in this relationship, this marriage with L. Ron Hubbard, who says that there's no Christ himself.
Well, wait a minute. Hold up, Brother Ishmael. Now, when I look at the symbol out front of a Scientology church, I see a big cross there with some stars flashing out of the side. What is that?
That is what it looks like. But let us look at this a little bit closer, Brother Lofton.
Yes.
What we find is we have the cross, but then we have it X'd out. So what we have to understand is that is an X'd out cross. So that is somebody who's saying that there is no Christ. And again, that is not a quote that's coming from anything written. There's an audio that you can pull up with Ron Hubbard himself actually saying it. So by him saying that there is no Christ, he's letting it be known that that cross is totally irrelevant to him. It's an impertinent symbol.
You know, sometimes truth is right in front of your faces and people refuse to see it, don't they?
Mm-hmm. Can I just say one thing on Alfredi Johnson?
Yes.
Okay, so Alfredi Johnson was also in Los Angeles, where he had like a storefront church, and I believe the name of the church was True Faith, and I believe it was in Compton or something like that. Mm-hmm. He also was some kind of elected official. I don't know if the term alderman fits out there, but he was city councilman or
yes,
something
city
like
councilman.
That. And he got recalled. The voters recalled him, and there was a lot of corruption and a big scandal surrounding that. I don't know the exact details, but he did get recalled. He got very close to Tony Muhammad, who is the minister, the West Coast regional minister of the Nation of Islam under Minister Farrakhan, and he got very close to Tony and, quote, saved his life and brought Tony to the Church of Scientology to get healed and all this other stuff. So he is what you would call Tony Muhammad's handler. He
yes.
stays next to him. They're joined at the hip. You know, they're very, very close. And he's presented to the Nation of Islam. He's always everywhere. You could pull up Save His Days. You'll see him on stage and everything else. Now, these handlers all, according to former Scientologists, all have a financial interest in their subject not losing interest in the church because they get a commission for everything their people spend.
You have it right here at 88.5 FM, WHPK FM here in Chicago. This is The Focus Show. My name is Lofton Emenari the Third, and we are speaking tonight with Leila Wells and Ishmael Bey, and they are broaching this subject. It's a hot subject, too. The Scientology, the Nation of Islam, the black community, boy, the intrusion of Scientology in the black community. Now, you just mentioned Tony Muhammad, who is the Western Regional Minister up under Minister Farrakhan, and Alfredi's handling of this man. So I guess that would be perhaps what we would call the inroad to the Nation of Islam?
Yes, that is definitely true. Like I said, it was that relationship that kind of started the segue of the Nation of Islam as a whole coming under that umbrella mm-hmm. after the experience of Tony Muhammad, allegedly. However, what we've also come to find out mm-hmm. is that coming from Tony Muhammad himself, as well as Minister Farrakhan, which has been verified, that Minister Farrakhan himself.
Yes, looks like.
Okay, well, I know what he's getting ready to say.
Yes.
But he was getting ready to say that Minister Farrakhan himself has been involved with Scientology for over 32 years. And so Alfredi and the minister knew each other from back in the day, and then Tony became involved. But there's a lot of people that were involved with this relationship, because even Isaac Hayes was in Ghana, I believe it was in 1991, and there's pictures of him in Ghana with Akbar Muhammad, who was the international representative of the Nation of Islam.
That's right.
And that was in 91, and Isaac Hayes was there doing Scientology, like mission work. Or whatever, trying to build something for Scientology. So there's a lot of there's people from the Nation of Islam who've gone to their drug rehab, Narcanon. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of ties. This is not a new relationship that Tony Muhammad did. Tony Muhammad became involved in, was it like 2005 somewhere? It's some 2004, 2005 somewhere right around there.
Absolutely astonishing. We're going to try to get Ishmael Bey back on our live line. We're going to take a brief pause for the cause, and we'll be right back with, I guess, Leila Wells, journalist, and Ishmael Reed. Ishmael Reed. I was about to say Ishmael Bey in just a moment. Okay, we're back with our guest, Leila Wells and Ishmael Bey. And Brother Ishmael, you were telling us about the association of Minister Farrakhan with Scientology. It goes back 30 years.
Yes, yes, absolutely, Brother Lofton. What we've come to find out is that this relationship has been going on, or he's been keeping his eye on this merger for approximately 34 years now.
Mm. Now, when you say merger, what are you saying?
Like, what they actually officially call this now is an actual marriage and a merger with the Church of Scientology.
Wait a minute. Hold up. Hold up. Are you saying that the Nation of Islam under Minister Louis Farrakhan is somehow merging with the Church of Scientology?
Absolutely, Lofton. And not only that, they have actually converted every mosque of the Nation of Islam into study tech centers. So the studies that they used to have on Wednesdays and on Fridays have officially been turned over from a mosque into a Scientology study tech satellite center.
In 2009, Minister Farrakhan announced the marriage, that's a quote, between the Nation of Islam and the Church of Scientology. That was in 2009. Mm-hmm. And you fast forward 3 years later to right now, mm-hmm. and they have... They're teaching Scientology to the children at Muhammad University. The minister, we just got a video where he is telling, not only did they have to do Dianetics, which is the first step on the bridge to total freedom, but his laborers now have to actually go what they call clear. That is a few steps up the bridge to total freedom, but it's a couple of steps beneath the level where you find out there is no Jesus or Allah or Muhammad. So now the stipulation is their laborers have to go clear in Scientology. And I urge your listeners to look up the bridge to total freedom also.
Now, wait a minute.
And on that same video, mm-hmm. he said that he is going to make Chicago or get a training center in Chicago the same way that the Scientologists have in Tampa, which basically he's saying a Scientology training center where he could send our people out into the community, which is what is going on with the FOI. And when the FOI are out there in the community supposedly to stop the violence and all the rest of that, they're passing out L. Ron Hubbard material from the Church of Scientology called The Way to Happiness. And we have pictures and video of them doing that. So they have the Final Call in one hand and Scientology in the other. Mm. And that's why they're out in the community, because they need those new people to come to the mosque and get audited, buy these books, sign up for courses, and everything else. Scientology is a business, and they don't do anything unless money is involved and unless contracts are involved. So him saying that there is a marriage between these two groups, that is not to be taken lightly.
I'm absolutely stunned. I mean, now, let me ask you this now. What could possibly benefit the Nation of Islam merging with the Church of Scientology? It's beyond me, but maybe you could answer that one.
Well, I think Leila had it correctly when she said that Scientology is a business.
Yes.
You know, it really depends on if you're a believer of the scripture. You know, it says basically, you know, what good is it that have the entire world but lose your soul?
Mm.
That's the dilemma that you have to face when you're dealing with an organization like Scientology.
Mm-hmm.
Is it worth your soul in order to make a little bit of money?
Yes.
Or how much are you worth?
So, but
obviously there's uh-huh. been a price involved.
Well, but Brother Ishmael, come on now. what about all the quote unquote teachings, or and all the mythology that's associated with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad that was passed along, of course, to Minister Farrakhan? Has that gone out the window?
I mean, actually, Brother Lofton, what you will find is that the core teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad have been altered completely.
Yes.
What you will find is they are actually teaching from the rostrum now that the founder of the Nation of Islam, Farad Muhammad, Master Farad Muhammad, that he cleared the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
and that he met L. Ron Hubbard.
No! Wait.
Okay? These people have gone way out of the box. They're using the name of Elijah Muhammad to justify this. They're using Bible scriptures of Jesus casting out demons. Now, let me just go back, please, 1 minute on what is the benefit of this relationship. Now, from what I understand in my own research and our former Scientologist, is that what Scientology needs is what you would equate to slave labor. Mm. They need bodies in their organization. So let's say you can't afford these courses. Like, I don't have any money, so I can't afford it. Oh, that's okay. Come down here and volunteer. So you go down there, and while you're volunteering at these what they call orgs, then they snow you with that you can take even more courses as long as you keep volunteering. And before you know it, so you're getting brainwashed when you're doing these courses,
yes.
And now before you know it, you're a real-life slave working for $50 a week at the org, but you're getting all the courses that you could possibly handle. Now, the Nation of Islam, I'm not 100% clear on what they need, but one thing that I know they need is longevity, and the Nation of Islam's membership was also down, as was the Church of Scientology. So the way that the minister is speaking about this marriage is that this is something, if I could leave you with something, the best thing I could leave you that you already got, which is the supreme wisdom, but if I could leave you with something else, it would be this technology or this teaching or something like that, that he worded it, meaning like this is going to be in effect after I die.
Mm. So in other words, he's putting things into place right now to see it, that the Church of Scientology carries on where he's leaving off.
Yeah, and see, the Church of Scientology, they don't do mergers, okay? They don't do, they swallow you.
Yes.
Okay, so they are going to swallow the Nation of Islam. There is no merger. The Nation is doing Scientology. Scientology is not doing NOI teaching.
Yes, of course. Wow. I mean, that's just absolutely mind-boggling. Now, in terms of the Nation of Islam being swallowed whole, you can most certainly see that Scientology is trying to make its treacherous inroads to the greater black community with this step.
Yeah. Okay, I was going to say, I was listening for Ishmael. Go ahead, Ishmael.
Go ahead, Leila.
Okay, yeah, Scientology was never, ever. First of all, L. Ron Hubbard was a racist, okay?
Yes.
Couldn't stand black people. For the minister to even try to get away with saying, if he was a racist, it goes into the ground with him. That is not going to fly for the rest of the black community. So, number one, the founder of the religion was a racist, so they were never, ever interested in saving black people or giving the black people on the bridge to total freedom. But, so L. Ron Hubbard is dead. Scientology is, they've gone through Hollywood. They're being made a joke. The master movie is out, which makes them a joke also. And so now they're a dying religion. And who does anyone turn to when they're dying are the colored folks. So now they're coming to the poor black community to revive their failing religion. And the owner or the top person in Scientology, David Miscavige, is on video saying that we could use black people to make Scientology cool. Like, we're the trendsetter, so like as soon as we jump on board, then every more people are going to jump on board because we'll make it cool.
And you know, when you say the poor black community, listen, they've all of a sudden realized how much economic power the black community in America actually possesses.
And if it's a few things that black folks will spend money on, like, yeah, we may have a poor community, but we'll spend money on three things: liquor, lotto, and the Lord. So you come to them with another religion. We are the most religious people ever, and these people in the Nation of Islam are attacking Scientology because the minister said it with such a zeal that it is just disgusting that they just turn themselves over to these people without any research at all.
Well, just a couple of weeks ago, a couple of months ago, I went to, had the opportunity to go to Minister Farrakhan's address to the black community at Mas Mariam the last time he was there publicly. And
July 2nd,
I was there, and I found it quite odd that the very first thing that he said was to not apologize for his association with Scientology.
No, he said attaching let's use his word, attaching. I'm getting a lot of criticism for attaching the nation to the Church of Scientology.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. You saw the video.
Oh, of course.
The first thing he said. Now, that at the time, that really went over my head because I was like, what is he talking about? But now we know, and now has this thing with his association with Scientology, has it gone fully public yet?
It's been pretty much, it's been brought out into the public or dragged out into the public.
Kicking and screaming.
Dragged would be more appropriate.
Yes.
Yeah, we were already, bringing it, the awareness to the public and ringing the alarm to the point to where a lot of what he was addressing in that particular part was directed at us directly. Mm. And it's also to be said in that particular lecture that he stated that he would no longer, deal with the topic. And to be perfectly frank with you, Minister Farrakhan does not have that authority. The black community has put a lot of trust into him as an individual.
Yes.
And he does not have the authority to tell the entire black community to not have any more questions for him. Mm. If he was just doing what he was doing within the confines of his organization, that's perfectly fine.
Now,
once you step out, once you step outside of that boundary into the open community, because you're now peddling these products into the open community, we do have questions for you. And it is not to be underestimated that we have trusted Minister Farrakhan in the past.
That's right.
Minister Farrakhan was the national representative of Wallace Muhammad at the time that Wallace Muhammad made a merger and a marriage with the People's Temple led by Reverend Jim Jones.
Mm-hmm.
And Minister Farrakhan was right there front row when Jim Jones was right in Chicago speaking from the same exact building that Minister Farrakhan was speaking from on July the 2nd.
Mm.
So with Minister Farrakhan being right there in the front row as the national representative of Wallace Muhammad, he does not have the authority, but he does have the audacity, the gall, and, to tell us that we do not have any more questions for him. Well, we trusted him once, and we lost almost 1,000 people.
To Jim Jones in Guyana, in Jonestown.
Mm-hmm. That is correct. That is correct. And you can see the pictures of Minister Farrakhan's front row at Scientology Invasion of the Black Community on Facebook.
And that's why it's irresponsible, and that's why it is disgusting, because when you have influence, when you are a person of influence like the minister is, and he is not only, he's gone past endorsing these people and saying, I found something useful, maybe you should try that for whatever problems you have. He married these two organizations. So in essence, the ignorant people outside of even his group and don't know this, like they don't know these people. So some of us take things on face value. Well, here is Minister Farrakhan telling me to do Dianetics. I'll just do Dianetics because I trust him. He's like a father to me and blah, 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 which is what happened with Jim Jones.
Right.
Those black leaders at that time gave him a pass. Mm. All those people were showing up at all his events. So that trickles down to the general public that this dude is okay. If that didn't happen, then all those people, I don't think would have been in Guyana, and that's why this is so disgusting and irresponsible for him to do this and not address these questions. So we do address those questions, and we do bring out the facts of Scientology, and it is up to these individuals to stop just going along with these black leaders, because you don't know what anybody's secret agenda is, and it may not match what your agenda is for your life.
You have it right here. Go ahead, Ishmael.
Yes, sir, Brother Lofton. We also wanted to make clear that this is not, we're not trying to, reconvert anyone who are members of the Nation of Islam.
Yes.
Our information goes out to the general population of those within the black community who have questions about this very critical topic.
Mm-hmm.
We're not trying to revert anyone back. There are also other factions of the Nation of Islam who do not subscribe to L. Ron Hubbard. They just subscribe to the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Yes.
And they're actually working with us in trying to bring the awareness to the community. So we embrace any of them as well. We just wanted to make that perfectly clear. This is not an overt attack on anyone, because it's not only the Nation of Islam that are under the auspices of L. Ron Hubbard, they're also the Black Church.
Yes.
We're trying to reach everyone in the Black community to wake them up.
Yes, yes. We have on our live line Brother Ishmael, Bay, and Sister Leila Wills, and they are talking about Scientology and its invasion of the Black community. You have it right here at WHPK-FM here at the University of Chicago. I am your host, L.A. Emenari III, and we are going until 9 o'clock tonight. We just got a few more minutes, and this is a subject that we really need to flesh out some more. I just wish I could get you on for a little while longer. We're gonna have to ask you to come back, because we know there's going to be some repercussions from this.
Well, we're trying to serve the community in any aspect, so we're happy to come back to WHPK. At any time that you request us, we are here for you.
Now tell me this, Ms. Wells. You got you have a new book coming out on this very subject.
Yeah, absolutely. And may I just say one other thing about what Ishmael had just said, is that this isn't just about the Nation of Islam, because
right.
according to Tony Muhammad, the same Western Regional Minister of the Nation of Islam under Minister Farrakhan, over 400 pastors in Chicago at that time wanted to or are having Dianetic seminars in their churches. Dianetics, they're also doing it in the school system, and if these people, the school system of M.U.I., and that's why you have to be careful, because they have a drug rehab program called Narcanon. They have a criminal reform program called Criminon. They have several front groups that our very vulnerable community would fit into. They have Applied Scholastics, where they have tutors who tutor at-risk children, and a lot of things that now our community has been opened up. We were a closed community. They were not in here, and the Nation of Islam has opened the door to these people. Now you have to be careful with every single thing that is going on, because otherwise your child would be sitting there getting audited by these people. But yeah, my next book is called The Final Fall. Yeah, I'm working on it now. It's not out yet, because I just get flooded with information both inside of the Nation of Islam, from inside of the Church of Scientology, outside of both of those groups, in the larger Black community. And that's why you can hear my tone, is because when I say it's disgusting, it really is disgusting. And the minister just needs to come forward and make a very definitive statement that, yes, we are a part of the Church of Scientology, or yes, we do have a contract with the Church of Scientology, or whatever, because it's now really big and it's not going to go away.
Wow. Now tell us about your group on Facebook. Now, I've seen is that you've got a lot of former Scientology people there giving you quite a bit of good information.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. We welcome them to come in. Many of them are experts in Scientology. They've been ex-members, but they were members of the Church of Scientology for 20, 25, 30-plus years.
Yes.
A wealth of knowledge and information. We have computer experts that come through, people who are cult busters and people who are experts in the cult and the occult sciences, coming in and sharing their knowledge and information. So we have a wealth of information on Scientology invasion of the Black community. We welcome anyone to come in to get the facts and the data, and that's all that we ask for you to do. Study it for yourself. Don't take our word for it. You can come explore the forum. The membership is completely free. You can view it, and then you can analyze the information for yourself.
Now,
also on our group, Lofton, if I may just for a second.
Sure.
Is that the white Scientologists who have come into our group, and some of them who are not publicly in posting in this group, they feel such an obligation, because when they saw our group and became aware of Ishmael and I and Professor Isel, they feel an obligation, because they've done a really good job with the white community, which is why Scientology is a dying religion. So one of them was like, felt so bad that they had spent so much time with the white community and nobody saw this coming, to that they'd never thought in a million years Scientology would come to the black community, but here they are. So a lot of them just are just genuinely trying to warn people because they've already been down that road and can tell us what's ahead. And Scientology, they never change their tactics. Like, they're very predictable. So they come in because they want to see us avoid the same pitfalls they've already been through.
Now, you've got this group forum on Facebook. Are you planning on having a website on this very subject?
Yes, we are. We're working on a website, and not only a website, but we're actually going to be having a video chat session. So it's the video chat sessions which will be set up so that we can engage with the public in a more direct manner.
Yes.
We'll be working on both of those particular projects. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yeah, and we have a lot of writings coming up, a blog coming up. Professor Isel has like a, I don't know what the name, I can't remember the name of it, but it's kind of like a deprogramming thing for people coming out of these cults. You know, the white community has dealt with a lot of cults. We're just becoming aware of stuff. We know about the Jim Jones, but now we're reliving black people in cults. And so they're coming out. So we have a lot of work to do, and that's why Ishmael welcomes all these people with their expertise, because we're gonna be paying for this as a society for the next 20 years by the time the nation gets finished doing whatever it is they're doing.
Mm, mm, mm. Well, you know what? I'd like to thank the both of you for coming on the live line here at WHBK FM in Chicago. And Brother Ishmael, do you have any parting wisdom for us?
Well, I would just like to, again, thank you again for having us, you know, on the station. We just wanted to bring, again, we talked about the good and the bad of what Scientology offers, but we left out so many other things. We just wanted to be able to share with you, if we ever come back, the aspect of Scientology where they actually, they have forced abortion, they support abortion directly from L. Ron Hubbard himself. Abortion is something which has killed millions of us as African Americans. Since 1974, we've had over 14 million abortions. He supports that. They also, you know, they're a form of the occult science. So we just want to be able to share more knowledge and information. For you to have us on your station on WHPK, we appreciate you on FM 88.5. So thank you so much for having us.
And Ms. Wells, when is that book due out?
I keep saying like 3 weeks, but like I said, I keep getting more, a lot of info, but it will be very soon. Can I just leave them with the website, though?
Yes.
Okay, I spoke recently to the cult expert. His name is Rick Ross, not to be confused with the rapper.
That's
Rick
right.
Ross. Okay, so his website is rickross.com, and there is a paper on there called Coercive Persuasion. And this paper describes very accurately what the Church of Scientology does and other cults and what the nation is doing to their own people. Coercive Persuasion on rickross.com. And I'll let you know, Lofton, as soon as the book is ready to be released.
That's right. We're certainly going to let everybody know. And, you know, and Rick Ross has a great, great website for his Cult Watch over there. Well, we'd once again like to thank the both of you. And like I said, we got to get you back on. And I want to thank you so much for imparting so much information in just this little time. The time went right by. Wow.
I know. Thanks so much for having us, Lofton. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. You're welcome. Thank you.
Welcome, welcome, three times welcome, Chicago. Welcome into the first hour of the Focus Show for this Friday night, November 30th, the last day of this month, 2012. I am your host tonight on the Focus Show. You know, we have a rotating staff, and tonight it's yours truly, L.A. Emenari III. I'm usually featured in my regular jazz slot at from Sundays to 2 to 4 every other Sunday. And tonight we're going to do something totally different concerning our listenership and the show. Hey, it's not a jazz show tonight. Not at all. In fact, we've got two great, wonderful guests. I'm going to pump them up. I'm going to build them up. Leila Wells will be in the first hour. And then in the second hour, you got to hold on to your seat. Dr. Sikuvu Hutchinson will be here. She will visit us on our live lines here at WHPK FM 88.5. Okay, hey, you know what? And speaking of Miss Will, she's on our live line right now.
Hi, Lofton. Thanks for having me.
Hey, well, you know what, Leila? I got to say that you were on the show, what was that, about a month ago?
Yeah, about a month ago.
About a month ago, and we talked about so much that we are going to have to investigate further down that street because, you know, I know you know.
It's just so unbelievable. I understand, believe me.
Yes, it is. Hey, well, you know, for our audiences that don't, well, that does know, and some that don't, about yourself, you are the author of the book Farrakhan the Movie.
Mm-hmm.
And you, of course, do investigative research.
Mm-hmm.
And as well as being the Facebook host of Scientology, the Invasion of the Black Community, which I've investigated right along with you. And it has to be the most intriguing and fascinating and popular by this by the time now, I would say. A month later, she were quite popular. Group on Facebook.
Yeah, the group was started 4 months ago by Ishmael Bay. He started it, and I'm one of the admins of the group. And like we said, it's only 4 months old. We have a little bit less than 300 members, mm-hmm. but our information is all public. And so we have so many heavyweights in our group just from all over. We have people who used to follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, people who, well, at least they were following Minister Farrakhan. We have former Scientologists. We have cult busters. We have all kinds of protesters, people from the group Anonymous. We have quite a few people in our group, and what we do is just provide information. Like, it's kind of slowed down recently, but we have information just on a nonstop basis, and our group members take the information and then it goes out, so the word has spread about this bizarre marriage between the Nation of Islam and the Church of Scientology.
Yes, it, and you know what? It is bizarre.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, for people, let's see, just like ourselves who've had our lives impacted by the Nation of Islam in mm-hmm. some form or another. And you were a former member of the Nation of Islam,
mm-hmm.
which gives you valuable insight.
Yes.
So you know of what you speak.
Right.
Yes.
And I don't try to portray myself as my only experience in the Nation of Islam was under Minister Farrakhan. So
yes.
I don't try to portray myself as a scholar on the Honorable Elijah Muhammad or whatever, but I have done a ton of research on not only the Nation of Islam, but on the Church of Scientology and a lot of other different things. And this move that he's made is, luckily though, the Nation has not been successful with pushing this over into the general public, but they are being successful at pushing it over on their membership. So, unfortunately, you know, because those people choose to just go along and follow this without doing any research of their own, they're going to have to dig themselves out of that hole that they're going to find themselves into. But luckily for us, we kind of hit it, and they weren't that successful with pushing it over on the general public. And for people who don't know, Scientology has left a trail of destruction with the white community. They never went to try to recruit blacks into the Church of Scientology. So it's been in existence, and you have members that were in for 10, 20, and 30 years, and they've left nothing but a trail of broken families, busted bank accounts, because Scientology is a business posing as a religion. Mm. So the Nation of Islam, to have done this, is so just outrageous. But we had a duty to our community that, okay, fine, if Minister Farrakhan wants to marry the Church of Scientology, then that's up to him and his followers. I personally was outraged just because I was a member of the Nation and thought it stood for one thing, and when he did that, I was like just personally indignant about the situation. But I'm not in the Nation anymore, and we needed to alert our community. So that with our group members, we've done a great job, and now it's kind of just like a gaper's delay, like on the highway. Like, everybody knows about it. They're just looking like, okay, what are they going to do next?
Yes, kind of yes. Thing. Well, now, wait, let me tell you, on that note, tell us, because we're gonna talk about this history that you found, but tell us a little bit more about your Facebook page and some of the people. You just mentioned Ishmael Bey, mm-hmm. and then who are your other administrators?
Okay, so Ishmael Bey and Professor Iself on Facebook, he is Professor Denham L. These two were the first people to actually go public with this information about the marriage. Ishmael was in the States here in the U.S. Professor Iself was in South Africa because part of his family had joined the Church of Scientology and wouldn't talk to him anymore unless he was a part of the Church of Scientology. So he kind of like went overseas to hunt his family down. He joined the Church of Scientology, but only for the intent purpose of learning their doctrine so that he could use it against them. He didn't go into it to become a Scientologist. He just went in for the purpose of freeing his ex-wife and his children from there, and he successfully did that. So he was in South Africa communicating with Ishmael, who was here, and so Ishmael's listening to him about what's going on over there, and he's like, well, you'll never believe what's going on over here. And so they compare notes. He comes back to the States, and they do a video, and several, you know, they did a lot of media. They did radio, a video, and all kinds of stuff, a documentary about this situation, and that was in 2010, even before the minister had really, like, he announced the marriage in 2009, but, you know, those believers, they're sitting there for, like, 3 hours listening to a lecture, so they don't know, you know, they can't process every single word that he said, so it kind of went over their heads.
Wait a minute, hold on, Leila. Okay. Leila, do you mean to tell me you're not going to give those believers any credit?
What, in 2009?
Yes, in 2009 for having at least an inch of a brain.
Well, I'll say this, though. Dr. Aleem Muhammad, he is on video saying that when I first heard the minister say this, I said, what is he talking about? Mm. But now I can see there is this beautiful relationship growing between us. So I guess initially some of their alarm bells did go off, but they completely ignored them and went along with it. But by the time 2010 came along, the minister, this was before he went public, like the first time he went public with this whole thing, in August of 2010, where, you know, we're going to be doing, nobody can be an official in the Nation of Islam unless they undergo this study. And I was at Mas Mariam when they showed this webcast, and I didn't even know what study they were talking about. Like, I was like, what study are they talking about? Then when 2011 Savior's Day came, it was all about L. Ron Hubbard, all things L. Ron Hubbard. I don't know if your listeners remember that, but they could easily look at it on YouTube.
Now, what happened? What happened at Savior's Day? It was all about L. Ron Hubbard.
Yeah, Savior's Day of 2011 was about Scientology and how he thinks that is the best thing for white people. that, like, if you're a Jew, you won't be a devil Jew if you go under the teachings of L. Ron Hubbard. And he basically was saying that he found something in Scientology, and he just talked for like, I think it's almost like 18 minutes on how great Scientology was. But before then, in Savior's Day of 2010, when he was saying that he was going away to get a new body, which is also part of Scientology's teachings, there were the handlers of Scientology were in the audience in 2010. So he just gradually piecemealed the information out, but this was something that has been in the works for a very long time. And
yes.
Then one of I think we talked about it on your last show that on the last show that I was on, where his West Coast regional minister Tony Muhammad had said that the minister had been looking at joining or uniting with this group for the last 34 years.
Really? Now Tony Muhammad already had his sights out for Scientology.
Yeah, Tony Muhammad was already sucked in hook, line, and sinker, but I think it's a little bit more to that story than we know. So
yes.
Tony's handler and the person who rescued him from the clutches of the world and took him like an ambulance into the Church of Scientology for his healing was this person named Alfredi Johnson. I know we talked about him before. So Alfredi saves Tony. Tony's life had reached a crisis point in his life. Alfredi took him to the Church of Scientology and took him under life repair, and then bam, Tony's healed and all, you know, just it's madness. But people can look that video up too on YouTube. The Nation of Islam makes oath to Scientology. But anyway, what my point is that Alfredi Johnson and the minister has said that Alfredi and the minister had met earlier on in the 70s, and Alfredi had wanted to join the Nation, but he went ahead with the Church of Scientology for whatever reason. So he's saying, so they paint a picture as if the minister was key in the path that Alfredi took into the Church of Scientology, and then swing around for a few years, and then he's the same person who happens to rescue Tony. And then the Nation of Islam and Scientology, let Tony tell it, have been together ever since.
Well, Leila, for the sake of some of our audiences who, FYI, Alfredi Johnson is, of course, now, could he be considered the Church of Scientology's black front man?
Yes. Well, their old front man, which was our brother Isaac Hayes, has passed away. So it seems like he is the new black face of Scientology. He and this other woman who they're trying to, I can't even remember her name, but they're trying to raise her up to be the new black faces, in addition to Louis Farrakhan. Like, I have a recent mailer of the Scientologists, and they have this black man on there with one of the famous Nation of Islam parts in his hair, and he looks just like an FOI.
Yes.
So,
he probably is.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. But the Nation of Islam believers are on Scientology promo material
and
videos.
Yes,
you know, but I just want to say one thing that I think escapes us, and I really, in my research for my first book, you know, Elijah Muhammad passed away in 1975. But we all know COINTELPRO. We have been affected by these groups that were affected by COINTELPRO. I'm a child of Panthers, the Black Panthers. You know, we have the Nation of Islam, SNCC, and Dr. King. All these groups were affected by COINTELPRO. Now, one thing that COINTELPRO specifically wanted after the death of Elijah Muhammad was to change the direction of the group into one of self-improvement rather than black nationalism. And after the death of Elijah Muhammad, that is exactly what has happened. So I don't really get into religious discussions with people about prophecy, because that's the prophecy that the Nation of Islam has fulfilled, which was the COINTEL paper from J. Edgar Hoover in 1967. And I personally am, I'm just not happy, because for my lifetime, since the 70s, we don't have anything to show for all of the bloodshed and struggle that we went through in the 60s. And I feel like the black leaders that we've had since then have really been playing games with us. And that's why I was really hurt when the minister did that, because he was the last person that I held in a very high esteem, you know. And when he did that, it just looks like we just don't have anything to show for it. But anyway, my point for that is the FBI wanted the Nation to be a self-improvement organization. Then in 2007, when the minister had that 12 to 14 hour surgery and was on his deathbed pretty much because of his age and the seriousness of the surgery, the Department of Homeland Security had a memo leaked. And the title of the memo said, "Uncertain Leadership Succession of the NOI Poses a Risk." So it's two things with that is, why wasn't Minister Farrakhan considered a risk to Homeland Security in 2007? And then 2 years later, so anybody who went into the new spot of leadership could pose a risk. 2 years later, in 2009, the Nation of Islam merges with the church, or marries the Church of Scientology. And nobody finds that curious. And now here we are, so the Nation of Islam now, that's why my next book that I'm doing is specifically on this time period, this marriage, because it's called The Final Fall, because no matter what happens, that the Nation of Islam now at this point, the Nation of Islam under Minister Farrakhan has been completely compromised.
We are speaking with Leila Wills, and she is a researcher, author of the book Farrakhan the Movie. And you have it right here at 88.5 FM, WHBK, from the University of Chicago. I'm your host tonight on the Focus Show, Lofton Emenari III, and we are streaming live at www.whpk.org. All right, Leila, you know, wow, you're a veritable tsunami of...
I'm sorry,
That's okay. Of information, because we need it. And I'm glad you're kicking it tonight with us. But now, you just laid out a history of Minister Farrakhan's involvement with the Church of Scientology. Now, this man, L. Ron Hubbard, is a bizarre man. Judging, just listening to the history of
Which history? The history of Scientology?
The history of Scientology itself. Now, you know, your Facebook page has brought all kinds of people there,
mm-hmm.
from in and out, just as you said, from the Church of Scientology to Minister Farrakhan watchers and Nation of Islam watchers.
Mm-hmm.
And just as you rightly said, you don't get into prophecy.
Yeah.
Because both groups have their own spooky kind of stuff going on.
Mm-hmm.
Their own religious doctrines and dogma.
Mm-hmm.
And not to insult them, but I think, to be quite honest with you, these organized religions, starting with those two, have insulted a lot of us,
mm-hmm.
Quite frankly. But in speaking of insulting, L. Ron Hubbard.
Mm-hmm.
How is it possible Minister Farrakhan can even walk in the same room with this man? But before that, you know what? Another thing that your website, your Facebook page brought out, and that was of Minister Farrakhan's association with Jim Jones. Just last night, I believe it was on the History Channel, a 2-hour documentary on Jim Jones and Jonestown.
Oh, really?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Just last night, and I thought about you because I've seen those pictures,
mm-hmm.
of all those dead bodies,
mm-hmm.
and I've seen those pictures of Minister Farrakhan standing up there sitting there in the rostrum with Jim Jones.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely amazing.
It is.
And that's some of the history that you've been making available.
Yeah, and see, the thing is that... Another thing about our great, fabulous group members is that a lot of our group members have works in production. You know, there's books being written, there's videos being done, there's documentaries and everything else. Because during my research for my first book, when you try to research that period from 1975 or even when the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was alive, but definitely after his passing, mm-hmm. until the 80s, all you have is a whole bunch of hearsay. This one says this. This one was against that. And so the pictures that we have didn't even come from the Nation of Islam.
Yes.
The pictures that we have came from a documentary from, I think it was NBC, and if not MSNBC, called Witness to Jonestown, where you're watching this documentary that one of our group members posted, because I hadn't seen it until she did.
Mm-hmm.
And she posted this video, and you watch it, and then, bam, here comes a big picture. Now, the general public watching this doesn't, they don't know what they're looking at, but here is Jim Jones in circa 1976 at the rostrum at Temple Number 2 in Chicago.
Right here in Chicago.
Yes. The Nation, like, not only was he inside the Nation of Islam, but he is at the rostrum teaching at the, I don't know what he was saying because it's just a still photo, but
yes.
Behind him are seats of, you know how they do these dignitary kind of seats, and there is Minister Farrakhan sitting there looking at Jim Jones. Now, before that picture, the only picture I got was, I think, was from Seventh Fam's website of, you know, when Wallace went out to L.A. to unite with Jim Jones. But the good news through all of this, and Jim, the anniversary of the Jonestown tragedy just passed, which was November the 18th.
Yes.
And our community now is becoming aware of cult behavior. We're cult, joining cults, we have cult awareness, and I tell people that I definitely was in a cult. Like, there's no ifs, ands, buts about it. The cult leader is somebody who, you know, has, Professor Eisel just came out with his book called Red Pill Diary, but it's actually true what he's saying.
Yes, I was going to ask you about his book. What's the title now?
The title is Red Pill Diary, and it's an ebook and it's a paperback and on Amazon. And he's saying how we hold these cult leaders because the cult leader has direct communication to God.
Yes.
Like, and that's what Jim Jones did, and that's what the Nation of Islam is doing right now. Like, if you don't go with Minister Farrakhan, Allah is going to kill you because he has, like, the messengers alive on the mothership and is communicating with him. He's directing his steps. This is, you know, divine, whatever they're trying to paint for this relationship with Scientology. We just, our community is now becoming more aware of cults.
You know, one of the themes throughout some of the ideology of the Nation of Islam is Minister Farrakhan's version, I would say, is this story you just sort of hinted at and retold a little bit of him visiting this mother plane, this spaceship in the sky.
Mm-hmm.
He goes to visit Elijah Muhammad, a long dead Elijah Muhammad. Tell us that story.
Well, the timing of the story is really interesting.
Yes.
Because the story takes place, he did this in 1985, where that's where he relayed the vision, or I think it was 85 or 86. But it just so happens to be around the time that L. Ron Hubbard died. Now, when L. Ron Hubbard died, the Scientologists, like his crew, his immediate crew who knew that he was dead, got together and decided what they were going to tell the Scientologists. And they told the Scientologists that L. Ron Hubbard dropped his body and was living on another planet, but he would be back. And that's how come in all the Scientology orgs, there is a room with L. Ron Hubbard's name on it. Like, he has an office with his favorite liquor and cigarettes, Cools, a pack of Cools waiting for his return. Now, shortly, somewhere around that time, Now, the Nation of Islam's history goes like this, and Jibril, who is Bernard Kushmir,
yes.
When Farrakhan separated from Wallace D. Muhammad in the 70s, Kushmir and the minister got together, and Kushmir had this theory on that Elijah Muhammad really wasn't dead; he was alive.
Now, didn't they publish a wasn't there a book on this very subject that was written by Jibril? I seem to remember one.
Yeah, is it possible he's still alive?
Right, that's right, that's right.
But you can't hardly get your hands on this book. Like, the book, like, there's a book.
The book,
you know,
is
like,
the...
There's a book.
It's the stuff of legends, I'll tell you.
But you just can't get your hands on this book. But from what I was able to dig up, Jibril based his theory on the Dead Sea Scrolls, the Bible, and I don't know where else. But it definitely, and like I said, I'm not a scholar on Elijah Muhammad, but it definitely goes against the teachings that I know of Elijah Muhammad about life after death.
Yes.
And this, that, and the other. Now, he did teach on the mother plane and baby planes, or otherwise known as UFOs,
mm-hmm.
but that is something different than saying somebody who was physically alive is now on one of those directing somebody that's here,
Leila,
telling them to go into the Church of Scientology.
Leila, I'll be quite frank with you. Both of them are bizarre.
Yes. But the minister has rebuilt a lot of what the Nation of Islam is about now.
Yes.
Is built on that premise.
Mm.
On the premise that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is alive.
Come on with it. Come
on. You
know,
because that is, he had a Savior's Day in 1981 where he said that, you know, he came public with this theory and everything else. But a lot of his divinity is based on the divinity of Elijah having risen to
yes.
the status from the messenger of Allah into this exalted Christ, and which also goes against the original doctrine of the nation. But anyway, Elijah has now risen to the exalted Christ, where that means the minister status has also risen.
Yes.
And so now they refer to him as the messenger of Allah and a lot of other
things. Wait a minute. Hold on. What did you just say? They refer to whom as the messenger of Allah?
The minister.
Do they?
The messenger of Allah.
Really?
Yes. Now that it's becoming public, see, they'll try to reword it, but if you just let them flow, he is the messenger of Allah. And it's for a lot of reasons that, from where I see,
yes.
that when you raise somebody to, see, our people, that's how come we have to be aware. And we have, since slavery, have bought into these kind of fairy tales, and that's why I'm glad it's all coming to light, because we have to mature past this. But at the same time, for me as a former member, and other people who were former members, shouldn't really feel too bad that they went along with this, because, you know, it's superstition and things that we picked up from slavery. But we just have to become more mature as a people and move past this. But as soon as these people try to wrap you up, this is my warning sign personally, as soon as they try to wrap me up into the Bible scriptures or anything like that and start pointing to who this is and who that is, that's when I'm done with the conversation. I'm done.
Personally, boy.
At this point of my development.
Yes.
Because, you know, I didn't join the nation for religion. I joined because they said that they were going to rebuild what the Nation of Islam had before it fell, and get all the, you know, businesses, build our communities, hospitals, schools, those institutions. That's what I had joined for. But before you know it, you're just religious, and that's it.
You're religious. Well, let me tell you, Leila, let me tell you this.
That's terrible.
Now, some of them may have joined because of the very altruistic motives that you've just pointed out, but I got to tell you, a big dose of that attraction is idol worship of Farrakhan, of Minister Farrakhan, as much as I respect him and all that sort of thing. But I believe half the people are worshiping his personality.
Mm-hmm.
And they know he has the personality to bring those folks in there with their money,
mm-hmm.
and depart with all their possessions and be religious, as you just said.
Right.
Oh.
You know, since the nation married the Church of Scientology, it's a subtle thing that's happening. And a
yes.
lot of the Muslims who are not in Chicago, L.A., and Florida don't really know how deep the nation is in bed with the Church of Scientology. But they are doing all things Scientology, from business tech to administration tech, and now they started their Scientology's high pressure fundraising. So when you just said that they tell people, you know, to come there with all their money or whatever, you know, the believers have to give him $10 million by Savior's Day February.
This coming Savior's Day.
Yes.
Now has that been a public edict?
To them, it has. I found out from people on the inside, but my people on the inside, the information is going to stop pretty soon, because the only people they're all just exiting. So the only people that are going to be left are the worshipers, and that's it.
You have it right here at 88.5 FM WHPK, emanating from the University of Chicago, right here on the corner of 57th and University, extending to Hyde Park and beyond. And our guest tonight on the Focus Show is Leila Wells. I am your host, L.A. Emenari III, and we're gonna take a short pause, a short break, and get to a couple of doodads before we come back with our conversation.
The National Institute of Mental Health reports that one in four adults will experience a mental health disorder in a given year. By 2020, major depressive illness will be the leading cause of disability in the world for women and children. I'm Representative Patty Ballock from Illinois. On behalf of women in government, I urge you to talk to your health care provider about early identification and treatment. Without treatment, the consequences for the individual and society are staggering. Disability, unemployment, substance abuse, homelessness, inappropriate incarceration, and wasted lives. Untreated mental illness in the U.S. results in an average cost of $100 billion annually. Common treatments for serious mental illnesses are highly effective. Between 70 and 90% of individuals have significant symptom relief and improved quality of life. Please visit womeningovernment.org. That's womeningovernment.org.
It takes 12 years to create a graduate. It takes about the same time to create a dropout. And at the end of the day, the difference between a child becoming one or the other could be you. So United Way is asking you to make a pledge. Tutor a child who needs help. Mentor a kid who needs someone on their side. Volunteer to read to children. Because when a child advances, we all advance. Be a reader, tutor, or mentor. Give, advocate, volunteer. Live United. Take the pledge now at liveunited.org. Brought to you by United Way and the Ad Council.
We are back here at the Focus Show. My name is L.A. Emenari III, and our guest tonight is Leila Wells in this first hour. And we are talking about the strange marriage of the Nation of Islam and the Church of Scientology. Okay, Leila, let's get back to this guy, Alfredi Johnson. You know, if looks were everything, now, you know, and some of us see these things on the surface, his perception. When you see Alfredi Johnson, guess what he's got? He's wearing a bow tie all the time.
It just seems like everything they do is mockery, though. Like, I'll put on my bow tie, you know, power to the people and all that stuff. But the reality is that Scientology does not believe in Jesus, Moses, Muhammad, or anybody else.
Really?
Yeah.
Wait a minute. Hold on. Church of Scientology. Are they Christians?
No, they're not Christians. They just use the word church because L. Ron Hubbard was very, very calculating on the psyche of people. So, of course, as soon as you hear the word church, you think Christian, and what do they come with? Is some kind of cross, which some of our group members have broke down in their symbology. I'm just not well-versed in the symbolism, but they've already broken down this sinister cross that of the Scientologists, what they use. But no, they don't believe in that. But the level of operation that the Nation of Islam is on, where, remember when they were saying, we're not doing Scientology, we're only doing Dianetics.
Well, right, exactly.
Then, they have graduated from Dianetics into Minister Farrakhan telling all of his officials that they have to go clear. Now, after clear is several stages up on the bridge to total freedom. That's what the listeners should Google, bridge to total freedom, and you'll be able to see the scale that people have to climb in Scientology, which every rung on the ladder costs money.
Now, tell us though. What is Dianetics?
Yeah, I just want to say one quick.
Yes.
One last
no, go right ahead.
Okay, because that's how come the Muslims will say we're not Scientologists. We believe in the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and blah 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 blah. But the reality is Scientology doesn't believe in the supreme being or all those other the prophets or messengers or anything like that. So you really, if you're doing Scientology, if you're doing Dianetics, if you're doing auditing or admin tech, business tech, you are practicing Scientology.
Like, yes,
that's
you
what
are.
Their religion is.
Yes.
So anyway, Dianetics pretty much is book one on the first rung of the ladder of the bridge to total freedom. It's just a book where L. Ron Hubbard compiled all this so-called wisdom from all over the place and put it in his language and called it the science of mental health. So what are the Muslims doing running around calling Dianetics a science just because this white guy said it was? You
now,
know,
now,
they've
now,
done no research at all. Now, is it okay if I bring up one other thing?
Yeah, no, go right ahead. Hey.
Okay. So this is a little unrelated, but not really. But since this has become public knowledge, this marriage between the Nation of Islam, Louis Farrakhan's Nation of Islam, and the Church of Scientology, you know, he has already had detractors through the years for various reasons. And so since this has happened, it has really been a Pandora's box because people from all over are talking about all kinds of stuff in regard to Louis Farrakhan and the Nation of Islam.
Yes.
And one group in particular are people who hold Dr. Khalid Muhammad in very high regard. Khalid was the supreme captain of the Nation of Islam. He was with the minister when the minister was starting to rebuild the nation, and he ended up being silenced from the minister during the early 90s, during a time where the minister was getting closer to the Church of Scientology. At that time, he either had already stayed at the Celebrity Center for his cancer treatment, or he was getting ready to stay there, and he was doing the, you know, reaching out to the Jewish community and things like that. So Khalid was still talking the old Nation of Islam talk, and the minister silenced him, and Khalid went on to be the head of the Black Panther, the new Black Panther Party. But those people are very upset because when the minister was going on, he was talking to these pastors in Chicago. He used Khalid as an example of why we as in our people need Dianetics or
yes.
auditing. Like, you know, every time they do this, he's using Scientology when he does this, which is the Scientologists try to find your ruin. So Lofton, you come in, let me give you a personality test, and let me figure out, are you divorced? You had a problem with your mom? You had this, you had that. And as soon as I find that sore spot, I have found your ruin, which means that's what I'm going to capitalize on. So the minister is talking to these pastors, and he brings up Khalid and says, which is the beef is that this is all hearsay. Like, Khalid didn't say this himself, but the minister says some sister told him that Brother Khalid was abused when he was young, and, you know, he goes on into this story, but at the same time, what he's doing is pitching Dianetics and auditing to these pastors. So a lot of people have become very upset, and then you have the followers of Elijah Muhammad who are upset of him even using the name Nation of Islam and Elijah Muhammad while doing this. So however this is going to end, it's really not going to be pretty. So, like, let's say if the minister passes away in the next year or two. And so our people, you know how black people are. I mean the general population. They'll just be like, oh, well, maybe he did do the Scientology thing, but, you know, he did this, that, and the other. But then it's going to be this other group where, you know, it's not going to fly. So I find the timing of all this very, very interesting. I always go back to the Homeland Security memo, and in 2 years after that memo about where they were concerned about succession, the Nation of Islam marries the Church of Scientology. I'm there. That's where I'm at with it, and period.
Well, when I went to go see the minister back here in May or June, I believe it was.
July. Are you talking about the Scientology thing?
Yes.
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 July 2nd.
Now, that, of course, is on YouTube, but I was there, and I had a ringside seat, and I did see in fact, that's the very thing, first thing that Minister Farrakhan talked about.
Right.
He talks about actually not wanting to talk about the Church of Scientology.
and that he was under a lot of criticism.
Yes.
For attaching, quote, that is a quote. I've been taking a lot of criticism for attaching the nation to the Church of Scientology.
There.
Now, that part of that.
Plain English.
Has since been edited out.
Ah.
YouTube, if you go to YouTube and watch that, but I already have a copy of that. But if you want to, on YouTube right now, it doesn't start there.
Mm-hmm.
They took that part out.
Mm.
That
amazing.
That attaching part out.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, I was there, and the Church of Scientology's handlers were there. He had them get up, and in fact, there were several points in the his lecture where he just stopped and referred to the man that was there. What was this man's name? Who was there? I'm sorry?
Shane Woodruff from the Celebrity Center.
Yes.
In L.A.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He and then, of course, Tony Muhammad was there to give his testimony about things. But this marriage is almost incomprehensible. However, once you break it down as the way you did, we see Minister Farrakhan actually sliding right into place.
Mm-hmm.
Because of all the things that have happened that have gone down like clockwork right under our very noses.
Mm-hmm. And we don't have any documentation to show what has happened since 1975, well, we have very little, I should say. The messenger's brother wrote a book called Journal of Truth where, a lot of the books that were out were more of a theological debate kind of thing.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Instead of just actual facts on what went down. Like, I would rather read, because I'm not really trying to attack the doctrine or the who said what and the teachings and
yes.
all that, even though I know what I'm talking about, but I would rather see exactly what went down, because in the scope of history, we will be able to see who is who and what is what. And so when those Nation of Islam people call me an agent and all this other kind of stuff, I just find it ridiculous. But I do know that where they're speaking from is they're under that influence. And even though I had left the Nation a long time ago in 95, I was still under the influence of it, of the doctrine and the reverence of the minister and all that kind of stuff. And not only until you start doing actual facts, research, data, does that counter in your own brain, does it counteract that? But as long as you're spooked out on fairy tales and scripture, which are left to interpretations and things like that, it's dangerous. And now with them adding Scientology into the mix, I just really feel bad for the believers, but more so for the children at MUI. Like, I heard from some of the believers that they changed the library at Muhammad University, which is for the children in Chicago, into an auditing room,
mm-hmm.
For the children.
Mm-hmm.
And, we went into a lot of things on auditing and on your last show, but your listeners should really do research on the bad side of Scientology. The Nation will tell you how great it is, but they have no long-term case studies. You can talk to somebody like, oh, I just had a hit of heroin, that stuff felt good, but let's check with that heroin addict after a certain amount of time has gone by and see how that either added to or took away from his life. And that's what the Nation is not doing.
Well, I tell you, Leila, religion is that hit of heroin.
Mm-hmm.
We are speaking with Leila Wills, and she is a researcher extraordinaire, an author of Farrakhan the Movie, and we're talking about the marriage of Scientology and the Nation of Islam. You have it right here at 88.5 FM, WHPK. My name is L.A. Emenari III, and we are going up until 8 o'clock with Ms. Wills. And wow, Miss Wills, man, you know what? You be coming around with those haymakers on a brother with telling us this stuff.
Let me just tell you one other thing.
Yes.
That, some of our group members, and I go with them sometimes, which is really interesting and fun, but they actually have protests. They're protesters. They are either a family member of Scientology or they're just humanitarians or they're ex-members. But anyway, they go and protest at these orgs.
Yes.
Now, what do they, and they take their videos and pictures and everything else.
Now, wait a minute. Tell us who are, maybe some of the posters might not want their names.
Yeah, they can just go to our group, and the
yes.
people who post, you know, they'll be able to see who's who and what's what, because some of them are not under their names.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
But the ex-Scientologist members in that group are phenomenal.
Oh, yeah. But I'm trying to say that they showed MGT, which are the women in the nation, mm-hmm. volunteering or whatever they're doing at Scientology org.
Mm.
Now, Scientology, they don't pay you for those positions, or if they do, it's something very minimal. But usually when people are at those orgs, they're trying to pay for their coursework. So these Muslims have dove into this study, this quote-unquote study and technology, and are asked to give these huge amounts of charity and everything else. But you know, it's hard for me not to be people get on me like, you can't try to save the believers, and those people are adults and doing exactly what they want to do. But I just feel bad for them, because I know how that pressure is.
Yes.
When you're in there and you want to do the right thing, and you think that going against him, you know, you're gonna, you know what goes along with the punishment.
Yes, I do.
Divine hellfire kind of situation.
Well, you know, L. Ron Hubbard, this guy, a fiction writer as well, wrote a lot of fiction.
And a con man.
And a con man.
A pedophile, a liar, and everything else. So it's like, why would you even want to eat from that tree?
Yes. a tree? How about a dog pan?
Right.
Wow. Leila, now, I mean, this has just been absolutely phenomenal, all this information you got. Now, tell us a little bit more, though, about Professor Iself and Brother Bay's research that they've done alongside with you on that page.
Yeah, so they've been involved in it, you know, since the very beginning, and they were just able to connect the dots. So as soon as Ishmael found out what was going on inside of the nation, and he started telling Iself about it, then he's in South Africa after going over there. So he's like, I don't want to use the word traumatized, but he's like, oh, hell no. You know, like alarm bells going off and this, that, and the other. So he was able to, everything that the nation has done, those two have predicted it. So I would call them, and I was like, oh, my God, you never believe what I just found out. But they would already have said, this is what they're getting ready to do next. They're getting ready to do, you know, they're lying as part of the tech, and just all kinds of stuff that they could predict. So a lot of times, they don't have to hear every single little detail.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they already have, like, this big picture, and I've started to now step back into the big picture, because I was writing out every single detail, which is driving me nuts, you know. I just couldn't believe that these are the Nation of Islam Muslims.
Yes.
In love with this pig, L. Ron Hubbard. Another interesting thing is that the deeper the nation, pretty soon we're not going to hear anything from the believers anymore, because the deeper they get into Scientology, and if you criticize L. Ron Hubbard, like, you could criticize Scientology all day,
mm-hmm.
and they can hang with you with that. Like, they can argue with you and all that kind of stuff. But if you criticize L. Ron Hubbard, it's like kryptonite to Superman. It's like, that is the silver bullet. Who's the silver bullet? The werewolf or Dracula? One of those. But you know what I'm saying? Like,
yes.
L. Ron Hubbard is source. Everything that he wrote, when they go to that org, they put on headphones to listen to his tapes. Everything he's written is holy scripture. If you criticize L. Ron Hubbard, they have to completely leave you alone. So, which means that we have, all of us have friends and family that are in the Nation of Islam. A lot
yes.
of us do, I should
mm-hmm.
say.
Sure.
So, if you're trying to communicate with them, you're alarmed, you're hearing this, you're not liking what you hear, so you want to go to your loved one for clarification. So I would say that if you go to your loved one for clarification, don't criticize anything. Just ask questions. And, of course, they're going to say, oh, it's not that deep. She doesn't know what she's talking about. All we're doing is this, that, and the other. And because a lot of them really don't know. They didn't hear the marriage part. They don't really know that they are now one organization with the Church of Scientology.
Mm. Leila, we've only got about a few more minutes left. Now tell us tell us about your book, Farrakhan the Movie.
Farrakhan the Movie was a project that I started after, you know, like 2002. I wanted to do it on how phenomenal I thought the Million Man March was mm-hmm. at the time. So that was a research project that I had been carrying around, and I had been asking the minister to sit down with me and that kind of stuff, and he had agreed to in the beginning, and then you know, time just went by, and he got sick, and I wasn't, like, bugging him at that time, and so time went by, and he never did, and then recently, I was like, you know what, I've been carrying this around for almost 10 years at this point, and I'm getting ready to release it as a book. And then, so meanwhile, so I pick up the research again, and that's when I start finding out about Scientology, which I had never heard of before he mentioned it. I didn't know. I mean, I heard of it as far as the celebrities go, but I didn't know anything about it.
Yes.
And so I completed that book. It's been out, which is really a history on his rise in the Nation of Islam. And for people who were there, you know, they may not see every little detail how they would see it, but for us, it's very, very educational. So the next one that I'm doing is specifically just on this marriage between the Church of Scientology, but I am taking it way back to the 70s, which is when this whole thing started. And another person from our group said that he has a Bilalian News, which was one of the newspapers that Wallace D had after the death of Elijah Muhammad,
yes.
where it talks about Wallace meeting with the Church of Scientology from
yes.
the 70s.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now you just mentioned your new book. When should we look for that?
I don't know. It's delayed now, and I'm going back and forth with it needs to be a case study, but it also a lot of people really like the first book, so mm-hmm. they wanted it in that movie format again. So, we're going to do both. So at this point, like we said earlier, there isn't any new ground-shaking info, but I am going to go ahead and complete it now. I'm not sure of the exact date when it'll come out, but it'll be soon. It's not going to be like a long, drawn-out process. And then his time will tell, but I'm not going to sit here on the sidelines eating popcorn watching the Nation of Islam until whatever is going to happen. You know, we'll all see whatever happens in the end, but I am going to document for the sake of history what has taken place and from my vantage point how this came into being.
Leila Wells, we thank you so much for your dedication and research for making this all this information available to us. Because we had to get the word out about this. It's a quandary. It's a menace and a quandary, I just have to say.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the as you say, Farrakhan the Movie. Well, this is part of that spectacle.
Right.
And at this time, we don't want to be taken down with it.
Yeah.
To be quite honest with you. And our listeners, because that's pretty much how I feel about it. It's about 5 minutes to the hour of 8 o'clock, and we're going to say goodbye to Miss Leila Wells. Thank you so much, Leila, for coming on. You got any parting comments? Any parting
yes.
shots?
Yes, and so thank you, Lofton, for doing the show, because in this age that we're in, as long as people are aware that this is taking place, most responsible people will do their own research. They're not just going to go along with it. But the problem was that nobody knew that this has happened. So now that people know and you help by spreading the word on your show, you know, I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Hey, thank you, Leila Wells, and we will see you next time. This has been The Focus Show.